We came upon a little boy in a tree, this Peter. He had captured the wolf with nothing but a rope and a small bird. It was incredible.
A hunter in Northern Virginia talking about a little boy who fought a wild animal and made a gift to the nation.
For Thursday, April 23rd, it's All Things Considered. I'm Linda Wertheimer.
And I'm Robert Siegel.
Earlier today in a meadow just outside the Washington Beltway, a third grader named Peter outsmarted a wolf. Now the animal is sleeping peacefully at the National Zoo.
Sylvia Poggioli is at the meadow.
Vienna, Virginia is a rural oasis just outside the Washington Beltway, a leafy community that prides itself on law and order. But Peter's story of triumph began in flagrant disobedience.
Steve Inskeep has the story of Peter's cat.
Mara Liasson recounts the capture.
And we attend a parade to the zoo.
First, the news.
From NPR News in Washington, I'm Ann Taylor. An 8-year-old boy in the Northern Virginia town of Vienna is hailed as a hero today after capturing a wild wolf and donating it to the National Zoo. Officials are withholding the child's full name at the request of his parents. For now, he is known only as Peter. Investigators are still piecing together details of the wolf's capture. Officials now believe Peter was assisted in his quest by a small bird, a blue jay. A duck. And his cat, Fluffy. Other participants in the day's events included Peter's grandfather. Peter himself. And the wolf. The wolf is now under sedation at the zoo so that the French horns will not disturb the other animals. In other news, the Dow Jones average closed up 200 points today, and the dollar is up in world financial markets, while the ruble is holding steady with the euro, the peso, the kwat, the baht, and the yen. I'm Ann Taylor, NPR News in Washington.
It's All Things Considered. I'm Linda Wertheimer.
And I'm Robert Siegel. Peter's journey to heroism began just after breakfast on the Northern Virginia farm where he lives with his grandfather. NPR's Sylvia Poggioli has more.
Vienna, Virginia is a rural oasis just outside the Washington Beltway, a leafy community that prides itself on law and order. But Peter's story of triumph began in flagrant disobedience. The young boy ignored his grandfather's explicit instructions to stay on their farm. Peter unlatched the gate and strolled into the vast green meadow. Saw one of his friends, a little blue jay, who chirped to him that all was quiet, and it was calm for the moment. While Peter opened the gate, he didn't close it. A duck waddled through to swim in the deep pond in the meadow. When the little blue jay saw who had arrived, he flew down and landed on the grass to taunt the duck. "What kind of bird are you if you can't fly?" the blue jay said. The duck shot back, "What kind of bird are you if you can't swim?" and dove into the pond. Interspecies tensions escalated as the birds argued and argued. The duck in the pond, the blue jay hopping on the bank. A dark foreshadowing of the dramatic events to come. From the meadow in Vienna, Virginia, I'm Sylvia Poggioli, NPR News.
Birds weren't the only animals in today's battle. NPR's Steve Inskeep reports on Peter's cat, Fluffy.
Like Peter, Fluffy was supposed to be in the house, not wandering in the meadow. But house cats are descended from predators, and when Fluffy saw the blue jay was distracted by its argument with the duck, Fluffy decided to strike. "Look out!" Peter shouted at the blue jay. Just in time, the bird flew straight up into the tree, a tall, stately oak. The act of feline aggression angered the duck, which quacked at Fluffy. From the middle of the pond. The cat circled the base of the tree, gazing upward, and then decided climbing it was not worth the effort. Scientists say that there's a solid nutritional basis for this. A cat requires more calories to scale a tree than the edible parts of a small bird provide. Fluffy said later that while he may occasionally be lazy, he's certainly not stupid. Steve Inskeep, NPR News.
At this point in the morning, Peter's grandfather came out of the farmhouse angry that Peter had left the farm without permission.
Peter's grandfather was just doing what any parent of his generation would have done.
NPR's senior news analyst, Daniel Schorr.
The grandfather was a veteran of open field combat in World War II, and so he knew the meadow was a dangerous place. For example, what if the wolf were to attack?
Thank you.
Peter's bravery was at first little more than adolescent attitude. Boys like me aren't afraid of wolves, he insisted. But Peter's grandfather was not impressed. He grabbed Peter's hand, shut the gate, locked it, and took the boy home. Just as Peter and his grandfather closed the door of their farmhouse, a huge gray wolf peeked out from the trees. Peter's cat, Fluffy, scurried up the tree.
Peter stood confidently behind the locked gate, watching the show unfolding before him and plotting his next move. Mara Liasson has the story.
Peter, a Cub Scout, decided it was time to take charge. He ran into the barn, found a strong rope, and clambered up the high stone wall. A branch of the tree the wolf was circling extended over the wall. Grabbing the branch, Peter pulled himself over onto the tree. Peter told the blue jay to fly down and circle the wolf's head, and to do it without getting caught. The blue jay grazed the wolf's ears with its wings, while the wolf snapped at the bird again and again.
Thank you.
The wolf, being a wolf, was accustomed to getting what it wanted, but it wasn't getting that blue jay no matter how many times it chomped at the air. Meanwhile, Peter, who had just that week received his Cub Scout merit badge for knot tying, fashioned his rope into a lasso. He lowered the rope slowly, then looped it around the wolf's tail and yanked it up as hard as he could. The wolf tried to free himself by stretching the rope and thrashing about. But Peter used a marlin spike hitch to tie the other end of the rope to the tree. The wolf's flailing only tightened Peter's lasso. Very moment, a group of hunters emerged from the woods.
I was out with my friends from our klezmer band for our annual toot and shoot. Then we came upon a little boy in a tree, this Peter, who yelled, "Wait, wait!" He had captured the wolf with nothing but a rope and a small bird. It was incredible.
Incredible, but true. Peter then asked the hunters to help him and the blue jay take the wolf to the National Zoo. Mara Liasson, NPR News.
And now, the procession to the National Zoo. NPR special correspondent Susan Stamberg saw the pageantry along Connecticut Avenue.
At the front of the parade,
an exhausted but beaming 8-year-old boy. Then came the hunters, holding the rope that led the great gray wolf. And at the end of the line, Peter's grandfather and his cat, Fluffy. The grandfather said he was proud of Peter, but he did ask the question no one else dared ask. What if Peter hadn't caught the wolf? What then? And above the parade, but well below the hovering news helicopters, Peter's friend the Blue Jay flitted about, chirping happily to anyone who would listen, "What fine fellows we are! Look what Peter and I caught!" And if you listened very carefully as the wolf passed by, you could hear the duck quacking. The wolf had eaten the duck so fast that he swallowed her alive. Once the wolf was safely inside the zoo, the duck was removed and returned to Peter. I'm Susan Stamberg, NPR News.